Well, praise God for what He is doing even today already in this service. And as we enter into our final service of you not being here, at least not even a portion of you being here, I do want to just pause as we get started and just thank our worship teams, thank our media team. They have in many ways carried the church during this weird season that we've been in. And so thank you to so many of you who've spent countless hours, whether you're a staff member or whether you're a dream teamer. You have made a massive, massive difference. Now, this is the last day, okay? And I know that we're going to continue on and many of you will still not be able to come, but at least there's going to be somebody in the room next Sunday. And for that, we praise God and we are super, super excited about that. I do want to just spend a moment. You heard Ryan walk through the top five things that we want you to know about coming back to church. I want to do this and just talk a little bit deeper on each one of these. I'm going to do this very quickly, though, and we're going to get to the message today. But here's the top five things that we want you to know. We are going to provide you a safe, touchless experience. Now, that sounds like a weird thing, right? A touchless experience, which you need to know. That ain't church, right? We're going to come back, but obviously there are some things that we are hindered from doing, hugging and shaking hands and all that kind of stuff, but we are going to do our best. So we're not going to have a formal greeting time in the service. We're not going to pass the offering plate, little things like that, that we're trying to be safe. And so the first thing we want you to know is the following areas are going to be sanitized before, during, and after the service. So in other words, we're going to clean, 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 clean. Doorknobs, bathrooms, etc., all throughout each one of our campuses. Number two, I'm just going to prepare you. This is going to be the weirdest and probably the hardest one to deal with. You're going to be guided to a seat in a way that allows appropriate social distancing. We are encouraging face masks next Sunday. But think of this like a wedding. When you come into a wedding, you have to stop at the entrance and an usher takes you to an appropriate seat. That's kind of got to be the way that we're doing this. And I know that's going to be frustrating. Trust me, we don't want to do these things. We just have to be safe. And ultimately, we are held responsible. And so we want to do this in the best way possible. So we will sit you accordingly to a system that we are creating that allows us to distance you from other people, as well as get as many people as we can who show up for church on next Sunday. So just give us grace in that right there. And listen, some of you have been sitting in the same seats for the last decade, maybe 20, 30 years. You might actually like a new place in the worship center once you sit somewhere else. So that's a good thing. Number three, we're not going to be offering any preschool, children's ministry, student ministry, or on-campus groups for the time being. This is just, we've got to really focus our efforts only on Sunday mornings right now. And hopefully some of these things will relax over time and we're able to start some of those things back. Here's something you probably never expected the pastor to say to you, okay? If you've got kids who would have trouble sitting through an entire service, I want to encourage you next week, bring a tablet, bring your iPad, bring a phone, and bring some headphones. You say, I cannot believe you are saying that. Here's what I'm saying. They can be a part of the whole service here. They can be a part of the worship time, our prayer time. And then when I begin the message, remember, we also put out a children's service every single Sunday. Here's what you can do. You can take your iPhone out, put your headphones on your kid, and push play, and they can then watch the kid's service while I am preaching, or Ryan or Jeff. And so just a little tidbit for you there. Number four, socializing is encouraged in parking lots only. In other words, try not to crowd around each other, hugs. I can't believe I'm saying this, but you know where we're at as a country. And so we're just going to try to initiate that there. And then number five, this is so important. We still encourage those of you who are in that vulnerable category, those of you obviously who feel sick, or maybe you just don't feel comfortable coming back yet. That is totally fine. We will continue to offer online services as long as the internet exists. And so that's going to be forever, right? And so just know that. Here's my encouragement to you, okay? Let's walk in unity. This is going to be a different kind of deal. We are entering into a few weeks or maybe a few months of just strangeness. And so let's give one another grace as we walk through some very interesting days. But all that aside, we can't wait to see you next Sunday. We are believing God for great things. If you got a Bible, let's get on to why we came to church, right? Let's hear from God today. 1 Kings chapter 17. A few weeks ago, we began a verse-by-verse series through this great chapter of the Bible, and we have called this Never the Same. In other words, as you leave this pandemic, as we head back into whatever the new normal is, we want you to say, man, COVID-19 was a marker in my life. I was never the same because God did some things in my heart then that I've stayed the rest of my life. As I shared on week one, this whole chapter is a chapter about God's provision. Last week, we talked about how God provided for this man named Elijah through a bird, through literally ravens. Last week, there was a widow woman who was at her wit's end in dire poverty on her way to death, and she gave Elijah some food, and God caused her flour and oil not to run dry. In very simplistic terms, this was a woman who was generous before God, and God took care of her needs. So last week we read about a miracle of God's provision. It was an amazing story. I've called this message today a new kind of hope. A new kind of hope. Jesus provides us new hope. Do you believe that today? He provides us new hope, and this passage tells us how we are to view this new hope. And so, as we often do, I'm going to go ahead and give you the main idea of the sermon. If you are a note taker, I would encourage you to write this down. We'll come back to it at several different points throughout the message today. But here's our main thought today. God is the one who determines the end. Isn't that a great word? God is the one who determines the end. If I could just speak it for you in our Kansan today, it ain't over till the Lord says it's over. It ain't over till God says it is over. And I believe that by the end of this, you'll even see how 1 Kings 17, this Old Testament passage, just makes a beeline to the cross of Jesus and talks about the new hope that we have in the gospel of Jesus. So let's pick up right where we left off. We left off in verse 16. Let's read in verse 17 right now of 1 Kings 17. It says this, "After this, the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became ill." So this widow woman's son is now ill. "And his illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him." So this faithful woman, this woman who was very generous, this woman who gave to the man of God, her son has now died. Verse 18 continues, "She said to Elijah, 'What have you against me, O man of God? You have come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son.'" Talk about an awkward predicament for Elijah, right? We often don't think about Elijah at this point in the story, but you got to imagine Elijah just sitting there and seeing this whole scene unfold. And you got to imagine internally he's saying, "God, I didn't ask for this. Like, you told me to go to the brook Cherith, I went. Then you told me to go here and I have gone. You told me to ask this woman and I've asked her for food. Now her son has died." You ever feel like you obey God and things don't turn out the way that you wish they would? This is Elijah. This is the widow woman right here. At this point, Elijah and the sweet widow woman have both done exactly what God has asked them to do, and the son still died. As you saw in verse 18, she immediately begins to think that it is God's punishment upon her life because of sin, and she's angry at Elijah. "Have you come to bring my sin to remembrance here?" And we probably all relate with this widow woman at some point in our lives. Maybe you even relate right now. You try to do the right thing. You try to follow Jesus well. You try to do all the stuff you need to do, and life is still hard. You ever been there? "Man, God, I'm trying to do the best that I can do, and it's like it is raining in my life over and over and over." And that's where this sweet widow woman is. You know, Jesus never promises us an easier life. Nowhere in the Bible do you hear that. Some people give their lives to Christ and they think, "Okay, now all my problems are going to go away and I'll never feel pain again." That is never pictured in the scriptures. Jesus never promises an easier life, but he does promise his presence in the midst of those very difficult times. We don't obey God to have an easier life. We obey God because he is worthy of our obedience. I'll pick back up in the story. Look at verse 19. The Bible says this, "And he said to her, 'Give me your son.'" I would encourage you, if you got your Bible there, to underline that simple phrase in the Bible. "Give me your son." "And he took him from her arms and carried him up into the upper chamber where he lodged, and he laid him on his own bed. And he cried to the Lord, 'Oh Lord, my God, have you brought calamity even upon the widow with whom I sojourn by killing her son?' Then he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried to the Lord, 'Oh Lord, my God, let this child's life come into him again.'" Elijah simply says to this woman who is in the depths of grief, "Give me your son. Give me your son." The most valuable thing in your life which has just passed away, give him to me. Could it be that God is speaking to your own heart today, asking for the most important thing in your life, that you would just give it to him? Could it be that God is asking you to place the greatest burden that you have in your life, in your family, in your business, in your health, in your future, into the hands of God? Go back to the story. It's Elijah and the shot. You got to just picture the scene in your mind. It's Elijah and now this dead child who is laid out on his own bed. Elijah begins to call out to God, "Oh Lord God, have you brought calamity on this? Have you killed this boy? God, bring his life back into him." And it says that the Bible says that he stretched himself upon the child three times. You can almost just see him crying out to God. He says, "Oh God, please bring this child's boy, the life back into him. And God, have you brought calamity?" And you can just see the grief, see the passion of this moment. God is the one who determines the end. In every instance in your life, in every instance in 1 Kings 17, God is the one who brings the end. Remember the widow last week, she thought she was going to die. God determines the end. She thought her oil and her flour were going to run out. God determines the end. Now she looks at her dead child, and now Elijah's looking at the dead child, and we just need to reiterate it again. God is the one who determines what the end is all about. You may think that your blank, whatever that is in your life, is dead. You may feel like your life, your calling, your marriage, your relationship with a child, your business, your usefulness to God is done. And I think a spiritual principle we learn from the story of Elijah and this widow woman and this dead child is that whatever that is in your life, that greatest thing of greatest value, that greatest burden, would you give it to the Lord today? And you let God determine the end. What is it here? And what is a part of the new hope that God provides for us? Don't ever miss this statement. If you don't get anything else today, I want you to get this statement. Whatever you place into the hands of God is worth it. Whatever you just say, "God, I'm giving you this. I'm giving you the burden. I'm giving you my greatest thing in my life, the most valuable thing in my life. It's yours." What a great lesson from 1 Kings 17. Whatever you put into the hands of God is not wasted. It may be your last resort, but it also may be the very thing that God is asking you to do today. Why don't we wrap up this sermon series and this passage by reading the last few verses right here. Look at verse 22. It says, "And the Lord listened to the voice of Elijah, and the life of the child came into him again, and he revived. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper chamber into the house and delivered him to his mother. And Elijah said, 'See, your son lives. Your son lives.' And the woman said to Elijah, 'Now I know that you are a man of God and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is truth.'" I love that simple phrase there that we read at the beginning of this passage. And the Lord listened to the voice of Elijah. In other words, God listened to his servant. If you can just rewind with me in your mind to this entire chapter, we've talked about the response of Elijah to the call of God. Remember what it said? So he went and did according to the word of the Lord. Last week we read about the obedience of this widow. So she went and did. Both of them responded to the call of God in their lives. And now you see the response of God in heaven. And the Lord listened to the voice of Elijah. You may feel alone today. You may feel like God doesn't listen to you. I just want to remind you from the authority of God's word, God is a God who hears. He's a God who listens. Does that mean that God's going to answer every prayer exactly as you want him to answer it? Absolutely not. But what a great encouragement for your heart today. Wherever you're at, whatever you're walking through, God listens to the voice of his children. God, could there be any more encouraging word for your soul today than that? God hears the cry of your heart. God hears the prayers that you utter in silence to him. And so again, further reason to say, God, this is my greatest passion. This is my most valuable thing. This is my greatest burden. And Lord, I am placing it in your hands today. You know, what Elijah and this widow woman just experienced was quite the picture of God's presence and power. Can we all agree on that? And there's those times in your lives where the presence of God is so real in your life that just reiterates what we're talking about, that, oh, God, you really do hear my prayers. You know what I call these? It's a very spiritual, pastoral term. I call these freaky God moments. It's the moments that just freak you out when you've been pouring your heart out to God, and in all reality, you're not really expecting God to answer, and then God answers, and you have this kind of freaked out perception and perspective where you just kind of look towards heaven, and you're like, oh my word. It's exactly where the widow is, exactly where Elijah is. Part of the new hope of the Christian life is this. It's the truth that God hears the prayers of his servants, and in his own sovereign way and in his own sovereign timing, he reminds us of this truth. In this instance, God listens and brings the son back to life. Did you realize that this is the first recorded resurrection in the scriptures? Obviously, we're all familiar with the resurrection of Jesus. We know of other famous people being brought back to life like Lazarus in the New Testament. But this is the first right here, the first resurrection that God has done in the scriptures. Can I just come back to it? God is the one who determines the end. This was not to be the end of that child's life. God had other plans. Numerous other times in the scriptures, God shows us that he is the one who controls the end. And when we get to the New Testament, we begin to see what unfolds with the person and work and death and resurrection of Jesus. We begin to see that he has ultimate victory over death. This is the gospel. That God is the one who determines the end. And for every follower of Jesus Christ, this thing called death is not the end. In fact, it is a promotion for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. From time to time, I'll quote on a Sunday morning a famous pastor and author speaker by the name of Tony Evans. Tony Evans is a pastor in Dallas. His sweet wife, Lois, passed away earlier this year, just a few months ago. And I saw a little clip from the funeral where his son, Jonathan, he's also a pastor. He's a chaplain of the Dallas Cowboys. Dream job, by the way. If the Cowboys ever call, I'm totally leaving Christchurch. I love you guys, but I got to go where God calls, right? It's the story, right? His son Jonathan spoke about his mother's passing, and he spoke about wrestling with God over the end of his mother's life. I want you to watch this quick clip.
I was wrestling with God the last few days. Because this was a great opportunity that we can tangibly see your glory. Everybody was praying, not only in Dallas, but around the country and around the world. People were watching. Where are you? This was an opportunity for us to see your glory. And as I was wrestling with God, he answered. And he said, number one, you don't understand the nature of my victory. Because just because I didn't answer your prayer your way doesn't mean that I haven't already answered your prayer anyway. Because victory was already given to your mom. You don't understand. Because of the victory that I have given you, there was always only two answers to your prayers. Either she was going to be healed or she was going to be healed. Either she was going to live or she was going to live. Either she was going to be with family or she was going to be with family. Either she was going to be well taken care of or she was going to be well taken care of. Victory belongs to me. Because of what I've already done for you, the two answers to your prayer are yes and yes. Because victory belongs to Jesus. And then he said to me, you need to understand that I am God. And that I am sovereign. And my game plan is bigger than any one player on my field. So you need to trust in the Lord with all of your heart. And do not lean on you, but lean on me, because I have the ability to make this crooked situation straight.
Well, that is the hope of every follower of Jesus Christ right there. That death is not the end. I told you, you would see a beeline from 1 Kings 17 to the hope that we have in Christ. God is the one who determines the end. And so for every follower of Jesus today, man, what an encouraging thing for our hearts. That in every aspect of our lives, God is the one who determines the end. As we think towards the future, and none of us know when we'll die, all of us know that we will die. We don't know when, we don't know how. And the hope that Jesus Christ, that the gospel provides is this: God is the one who determines the end. And for the believer, death is not the end. It is an entrance to the beginning. And we will live with Jesus Christ for eternity in heaven. Perfection. No tears, no problems, just the presence of Christ. There are no doubt many of you who are watching today who, as you hear this message, as you hear even the message from Jonathan Evans, you think to yourself, oh man, I do not have what they all seem to have. I do not have any kind of assurance that the end of my life will be the beginning of eternity with Christ. You see, death is just the beginning, whether you're a Christian or not a Christian. Death is the beginning of eternity, and the Bible gives us two options: that you will spend eternity in heaven with Christ, or you will spend eternity in hell separated from Christ. And the hope of 1 Kings chapter 17 and the hope of the gospel is this: that God is the one who determines the end. And if you will turn your life over to God, if you will turn your life over to faith in Jesus Christ, you will have assurance. You will have peace. You will have the presence of God in your life. You will have hope. And that doesn't come through the world. It doesn't come through doing better at the office. It doesn't come with more money. It doesn't come with another relationship. It comes only through turning your life over to Jesus Christ. And so today, if you're there and you're sitting there, you're thinking, man, I feel like you're speaking right to me, Nick. And so what do I need to do? Because I'm feeling like something is pulling me towards what you're saying. That's the Holy Spirit of God. And here's the appropriate response to what Jesus has done for you on the cross and in his resurrection. The Bible says that you must turn from a life of sin. That's what you're living in right now. You're just living for yourself. You know what? My story was the same. Every follower of Jesus watching this broadcast with you, their story's the same. We all are born sinners. And the Bible says that you must change your mind. You must repent and come out of that kind of life. And you must not only turn to some vague God out there, some vague higher power, but you are saying, I am putting my faith in Jesus Christ. And I recognize that I cannot be made right with God. I cannot get into heaven without putting my faith and trust in Jesus Christ and what he did for me on the cross. But today, the new hope, a new kind of hope for your life is this: you can meet Jesus today. You may say, Nick, you have no idea what I've done. You have no idea what I did last night. I don't care, and it doesn't matter. What does matter is that God loves you, and God created you, and he is now calling you into a relationship with his son, Jesus. If that's the cry of your heart, I just want to pray with you right now. And if you would say, Nick, I am ready to surrender my life to Jesus, would you just bow right there, wherever you're at? Every Christian watching this, man, you're praying for people to come into a relationship with Jesus right now. Would you just pray this simple prayer? Jesus, today I turn to you. I turn away from a life of sin. I turn away from a life of living for myself. And I turn in faith to you. I no longer believe that I'm good enough, but I believe that Jesus is good enough. I trust in what he did for me to save me. Just tell God this. Just say, in the best way that I know how, I give my life to you. Change me. Forgive me. Save me. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. For those of you who just prayed to receive Christ, man, we rejoice with you. I wish I were there right now, and I wish we were not in the middle of a pandemic because I would give you a big old hug right now, okay? You just made the greatest decision of your life. And what we often tell people is now you need to tell somebody else. Maybe you're in the room with your family right now, and maybe you just need to turn to somebody and just say, hey, I just did what he just told us to do. Like, I just prayed to receive Christ. Here's the second thing we want you to do, though. We want you to tell us, because we want to get you in touch with one of our staff. And we can do this all through text, okay? What we're going to ask you to do is to text this number. Just text your first and last name. So text Nick Floyd or whatever your first and last name is to 479-343-8777. Again, you put your first and last name in there and just type in that number, 479-343-8777. You'll get a response from somebody on our staff, and they'll begin to text with you. And if you want to get on the phone, they'll get on the phone with you. If you want to try to meet up next week, they'll try to meet up next week with you. And all we want to do is to help you take your next step with the Lord Jesus, okay? Church, we've been through quite the experience. We are now, I think this is the 10th week, maybe, we've done this, 10th or 11th. I can't even keep up with it anymore. And I want to thank you for sticking with us. Many of you have been with us every single Sunday. You've been involved as you can. And we're trusting that God's going to use the last 2.5 months in your life and in the life of our church. And here's what I want to encourage you to do. As you come back to the gathered assembly of church, come ready. Come ready. This is a time for us not only to change individually and personally, but for us to change our church, to walk into a place where we say, man, I am expecting God to move. I am expecting to experience the manifest presence of Christ today. And how do you do that? That begins on Saturday, preparing your heart. That begins on Sunday, preparing, getting up early, getting ready to meet with Jesus. And so as we do that, I'm going to pray and dismiss us. And let's come ready May 31st to meet with God on all of our campuses. Jesus, we don't want to be the same. We don't want to be the same people. We don't want to be the same church. We pray for a mighty outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We pray for an outpouring of the manifest presence of God. I pray that people from all over our region would hear about what you are doing at Crossroads, how you have just come and sat down upon our meetings and our gatherings. We just want to see you. So God, prepare us for 7 days from now when we meet together. It's in the powerful name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Church, we love you. We will see you next Sunday. Bye-bye.